Okay, we will now resume. If I could invite those leaving the public gallery to do so as quickly and as quietly as possible as we move on to the next item of business, which is a member's business debate on motion 12992 in the name of Alistair Allen on Europe Day 2024. The debate will be concluded without any questions being put. I'd invite members wishing to participate to press the request to speak buttons, and I invite Dr. Allen to open the debate. Around 7 minutes, Dr. Allen.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. From time to time, it is as well to lift our eyes from the Scottish political fray to recall that Scotland is still a European country and that events in Europe still matter to us. I'm grateful, therefore, to have the opportunity for us to reflect on all that in the debate today. Almost three quarters of a century ago, the Schuman Declaration marked the beginning of post-World War II Franco-German cooperation, a hugely significant turning point in Europe's pursuit of long-term and sustainable peace. It came after a continuous period of over 80 years during which Germany and France had largely been either at war or on the verge of war with each other. The following year, in 1951, the alliance was opened to other European countries, with the Treaty of Paris also being signed by the Netherlands, Belgium, Italy and Luxembourg, this creating the European Coal and Steel Community, which paved the way for the European Economic Community and subsequently, of course, the European Union. Europe Day is celebrated on the 9th of May each year, the anniversary of the signing of the Schuman Declaration. And once again, however, the anniversary unfortunately fell and falls during a time of war in Europe. I would therefore take the opportunity, as I'm sure others would, to reiterate this Parliament's categorical condemnation of Putin's unprovoked aggression, which has destroyed the lives of so many Ukrainians since the country's illegal invasion of Ukraine in February 2022. And the Russian government's reckless actions during that invasion have, of course, also directly resulted in the death of many of its own forces. The European Union was established to promote peace and cooperation between Europe's independent nations. I, of course, very much hope that one day soon Scotland can count herself among these independent European nations. But for the moment, Europe Day represents an opportunity for us to reflect on the European Union's core aspirations, as well as the challenges it faces in today's landscape. Peace and cooperation are values we must pursue and prioritise, particularly in a period of political polarisation, when misinformation and therefore mistrust can be rife and, unless checked, ultimately pose a threat to democracy itself. The shared European values of human dignity, freedom, democracy, equality, rule of law, human rights are ones which I hope every individual across this chamber would share, no matter their position on Scotland's future or indeed on the European Union. However, I cannot resist saying that those who continue arguing against even rejoining the single market or re-establishing a freedom of movement of people are taking an extreme stance, and one which I don't claim to be able to comprehend. It is a stance which I personally would counsel all parties not to humour much further. Just a few weeks ago, yet more new, expensive and complicated import controls came into force as a direct consequence of Brexit, causing further damage to Scotland's businesses and our economic interest. More EU businesses are ceasing trade with the UK altogether due to the additional expense and bureaucratic headache which the trading relationship now involves. The UK has already suffered the largest five-year decline in goods trades since comparable records began in 1997, with the volume of UK goods imports and exports being 7.4% smaller than in 2018. Exports from my own constituency, particularly of fresh seafood, have at times suffered significantly due to the complex, time-consuming and expensive checks now required to be made on every box for every journey to mainland Europe. Any small error can result in thousands of pounds of produce being held up and sometimes ultimately discarded. In any case, Presiding Officer, I am very conscious that the bulk of those roads in my constituency, which are wide enough to drive two cars past each other without stopping, are largely the product of the EU structural and investment funds. The UK government committed to match the EU structural funding post-Brexit in a programme they insisted would be better tailored to our economy. However, we have found ourselves overlooked and short-changed. Meanwhile, the UK government and, as far as I can see, the main UK opposition refuses to move an inch from their opposition to EU membership. So I'm afraid that even with the potential for a new government in Westminster, This tunnel vision on anything related to the EU or the single market looks firmly set to continue. Last month, both Keir Starmer and Rishi Sunak rejected the European Commission's proposals for a post-Brexit youth mobility deal, for instance, which would have allowed those aged between 18 and 30 to live, study or work in one EU country for up to 4 years, and for young EU citizens to come to the UK on the same basis. Presiding Officer, Brexit was unquestionably an act of cultural and economic vandalism. Scotland remains a steadfastly European nation, bound to our neighbours by a long history of cultural, social and economic ties. And whilst external powers have forced us to leave the political European community, I'm proud to say that Scotland's esprit européen is something no external power can take away. I fear I may have annoyed one of your predecessors.
I'm grateful to
Stephen Kerr.
I'm really confused about the external powers he's referring to. We had a referendum and the United Kingdom voted to leave the European Union. What external powers is he referring to? Is he referring by chance to England, Wales and Northern Ireland?
Alistair Allen.
I'm referring to the fact that the country I represent in this Parliament and have the honour to live in voted two-thirds to remain in the European Union. I fear, as well as annoying Mr Kerr, I may have annoyed one of your predecessors, or the presiding officer's predecessor, when I and others spoke up in this chamber some time ago to make the case for the European flag to continue to fly outside our national parliament. I have no regrets about that, and I'm pleased to see it still flying. For me, it is a symbol of hope that in the not-too-distant future, Scotland will be able to rejoin the EU family as a member state. But more immediately, it is a clear sign that we want to celebrate Europe Day and all the ideas that that represents.
Thank you. We now move to the open debate. I call first Megan Gallagher to be followed by Claire Adamson in around 4 minutes. Ms Gallagher.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And before I begin, let me join with colleagues across the chamber by celebrating Europe Day in 2024. In a turbulent world, it is vitally important that we continue to express the close bonds of friendship with our many friends and allies across Europe. And that brings me on to the motion before us today. Today's debate on Europe is an opportunity to talk about the many virtues of a shared European heritage and culture. It's a chance to celebrate the long-established historical ties between the United Kingdom and Europe. And, of course, for me, it's an opportunity to reflect on the sacrifices our brave men and women who have courageously answered the call to secure the liberation of Europe from the tyrannical grip of Nazism. It is their sacrifices and those of many more who ensured that we have a Europe in the first place. But it is disappointing that the motion makes no mention of the 79th anniversary of Victory in Europe Day, a day of national and international celebration which has echoed across the world every year since the hard-fought Allied victory in Europe on the 8th of May 1945 was secured. I will.
Alistair Allen.
I thank the member for making the point about Victory in Europe Day. I am more than happy to acknowledge it and also to acknowledge the sacrifice of all those who secured victory in Europe.
Megan Gallagher.
I'm very grateful to the member for doing so, because it is such a vitally important date in European history. After all, without an Allied victory in World War II, spearheaded by Britain and her allies, the formation of the Council of Europe would never have been possible in the first instance. The SNP might possibly be unaware it was our greatest ever Briton, Winston Churchill, who first suggested the formation of the Council of Europe back in 1943. The Council of Europe finally became a post-war reality when it was signed into existence in London on the 5th of May 1949. The founding statutes of the Council of Europe setting out the guiding principles for their work on rebuilding a Europe that had been shattered by war. As a driving force behind its formation, it is unsurprising that we share values that we hold most dearly here in Britain, that of democracy, that of human rights and that of the rule of law. Article 1A of the statute states that the aim of the Council of Europe is to achieve a greater unity between its members for the purpose of safeguarding and realising the ideals and principles which are their common heritage and facilitating their economic and social progress. Presiding Officer, the motion before us could have recognised other significant European achievements such as the Treaty of Rome and the Single European Act, just to mention two more. But unfortunately, the speech that we've heard so far is just, I'm afraid, some waffle from the SNP, an opportunity to attack Britain, an attack on the democratic will of the people of the United Kingdom to leave the European Union. The SNP love to conflate the European Union with Europe as if they are somehow interchangeable. But, presiding officer, like the flip-flopping on oil and gas, the SNP have a track record of flip-flopping on the EU. If you look at the 60s, the 70s, the SNP were actively campaigning to take us out of Europe. In 2014, they ran a campaign of separation that would have taken Scotland out of the EU. Thankfully, the vast majority of people in Scotland rejected their idea of separation. They talk of Scotland being pulled out of Europe against her will, conveniently forgetting that it was the United Kingdom who had membership of the EU. The SNP also conveniently ignore that the fact that a third of their own membership voted to leave the EU back in 2016. Now, fast forward today and the debate whereby we have the SNP falling over themselves to shout about the benefits of being in a union. Well, square that circle if you can. You seem to have European unionism good, UK unionism bad. You literally couldn't make it up. But here is the crux of the matter. The SNP do want separation at any cost. They intend to rip Scotland out of the world's most successful and strongest union to achieve their goals against the wishes of most people in this country. If the SNP were ever to get their way, we would find ourselves outside of both the UK and the EU. If I can conclude, presiding officer, because I know I am out of time. At the founding of the Council of Europe in 1949, Winston Churchill said that our hopes and our work point to an era of peace, prosperity and abundance. In a volatile world where conflict is once more raging out of control, it is comforting to know that the United Kingdom is leading the way in Europe and ensuring that the long-term stability in the region will once again ensure that peace, prosperity and abundance returns to all of those in Europe, and that is a cause for celebration. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Gallagher. I now call Claire Adamson to be followed by Faisal Chowdhury. Around 4 minutes, Ms Adamson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I thank Dr Allen for bringing this motion to the Parliament and securing the debate in what is a very comprehensive motion. I was hoping that this would be a celebration of Europe Day and that we would all have a bit of consensus about that, but it has actually turned into a bit of an irony fest in my mind. It's to quote Winston Churchill and his attitude towards Europe and being part of that initial process, to then be defending an insular looking Conservative Boris Johnson, who dragged us out on basically a pack of misinformation, shall we say, with regards to European membership. So many people were told we'd lose the European membership if we had come out, if we'd voted for independence, and then they were faced with the Brexit vote. Europeans in this country left bereft, actually, about their future in this country because of Brexit. But I do wish everyone a happy European Day, and I would particularly like to, as Dr Allen did, extend my solidarity to the people of Ukraine. Europe Day 24 and its call for peace takes on a new meaning when we have war on the European continent. It was the inception of the European Coal and Steel Community, and the EU's precursor was foremost a peace project. Greater political integration based on mutual interest helped stabilise relationships between France and West Germany. Following the abject horrors of the Second World War, the EU in that light stands out as one of the most successful peace projects in history. And again, an irony, we have walked away from that. The values of peace, freedom and respect for the common humanity have renewed meaning. It should give renewed focus and much needed peace as the conflict in the Ukraine and other areas around the world continue. The motion notes that Scotland remains resolutely European, and we have already talked about how the Scottish electorate overwhelmingly rejected Brexit. And Brexit damage has been manifest. The Office of Budgetary Responsibility expects a long-term hit to GDP of 4%. Smaller firms and exporters have wiped out due to the costs of red tape and non-tariff barriers in their supply chains. I hear Mr Kerr from a sedentary position. I suggest he looks at the work of the Constitution Europe External Affairs and Culture Committee that I convene in this Parliament, where there's ample evidence on this point. Yes, certainly.
Stephen Kerr.
To Kerr Adamson for giving way. Because I remember during the indicative votes during the Brexit process in the House of Commons that the SNP members of that House had an opportunity to vote for Britain's membership of a single market, and they didn't vote for it. This seems like so much hypocrisy to me.
Claire Adamson.
We are here now facing the consequences of Brexit, Mr Kerr. And as I said, we have ample evidence showing the damage. Indeed, the Independent Commission on UK-EU Relations at Committee this morning, in their report on the trade of goods, said that although goods trade between the EU and UK recovered most of its previous levels in value of terms following a sharp fall in the early months, the current value of trade is well below what we would have expected had the UK performed on a comparable level with other trading partners. This is not an ideological bun fight, it's a brutal economic reality of the consequences for our constituents and the businesses in our areas. Is there a cause of hope as the Parliament marks Europe Day? Well, look at what we've lost. The right to live and work in 27 other nations, new costs and rules and cabotage are devastating for tourist artists, as our committee has heard from the culture community. We've lost Erasmus, Comenius, and extraordinary initiatives which fostered cultural and academic links. And it gave life-changing opportunities to our young people, something that my grandchildren are now denied. The EU is an integral to our trade and the majority of it. EU structural funding, as mentioned by Dr Allen, again provided crucial investment for areas in Scotland impacted by post-industrial decline, not least of which in my constituency in Motherwell, Wishaw, which was left with after the mining and the steel industries were destroyed with no investment, no move forward from the UK government until European structural funds built the Ravenscraig Regional Sports Centre. I'll leave it there, Presiding Officer, and just wish everybody a happy European Day.
Thank you, Ms Adamson. I now call Faisal Chowdhury to be followed by Karen Adam, around 4 minutes. Mr Chowdhury.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I want to begin by congratulating Alistair Allen on bringing this motion to the Chamber. As we mark the 74th European Day, we must never forget why integration was pursued in Europe. In 1950, in the aftermath of the Second World War, which caused so much death and destruction, Robert Schuman, the French Foreign Minister, called for European integration so war would become not merely unthinkable, but materially impossible. This principle should still be an important principle we abide by for peace in Europe. Yet, the event of the recent year shows this cooperation is more important than ever. The invasion of Ukraine goes against everything we have pursued for the last 74 years. It is imperative that our support for Ukraine remains steadfast and peaceful Europe remains the norm. The motion mentions the Festival of Europe earlier this month. There, I spoke on a panel with Ben McPherson and Christine Jardin MP. I urged that rather than caring about Brexit once more, we should move to building a new productive relationship with Europe, one built on our shared values of democracy, equality and rule of law, and deliver for working people. There are several ways we can do that. The motion highlights Scotland's loss of access to EU programme and what they can do for communities. The loss of Scotland's membership to the Erasmus scheme, which allowed thousands of Scottish students to study in Europe, is regrettable. Scotland should look at emulation the success of Welsh Labour's TAFE scheme, which has allowed Welsh students continued access to educational exchanges. Culture has also been suffered by Brexit. Performers and artists are held back by high costs to tour in Europe and vice versa. Brand Scotland and our status as a leading country for culture is threatened if artists cannot come here. An incoming Labour government could institute a new touring agreement with the European Union so artists can tour without expensive visas. The Scottish Government should look into cooperate on this issue rather than being stuck on the constitutional issue. Yeah, I'll take
Cabinet Secretary.
Treasury giving way. The current UK government has sensibly rejoined the Horizon programme. Does Mr Chowdhury agree that given that it has been possible to rejoin European programmes, a priority for any government should include rejoining Erasmus Plus and rejoining Creative Europe?
Faisal Chowdhury.
Thank you very much. Yeah, I would support that, but if we cannot do it, we need to look at other options. And as the Welsh Labour has managed to do a Tait, why don't we look at that? So I would say that our government should give that a priority too. Redoing the Brexit debate will not solve the cost of living crisis, but we can renegotiate the deal to better serve working people. To conclude, Presiding Officer, while Scotland and the United Kingdom may no longer be part of the European Union, we're still European. Our shared history and culture transcends any political institution. With the future being more uncertain than ever, we must have a collaborative relationship with our European partners. We must never forget what happened in the past when that cooperation was absent. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Chowdhury. I now call Karen Adam to be followed by Stephen Kerr. Around 4 minutes, Ms Adam.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I wish to congratulate Dr Allen for getting this debate to the Scottish Parliament. Europe Day 2024, as we've heard, marks the 74th anniversary of the historic Schuman Declaration, and as the motion states, it is a chance to reflect on the aspiration for peace and unity across Europe. 74 years ago this month, on the 9th of May 1950, the then French Foreign Minister Robert Schuman laid the foundations for the European Union with his renowned Schuman Declaration. His declaration opened with the line, "World peace cannot be safeguarded without the making of creative efforts proportionate to the dangers which threaten it." Those creative efforts began with a proposal of joint control of coal and steel production between France and Germany. And over the seven decades which followed, interdependence and cooperation between European nations went from strength to strength. The European Coal and Steel Community, the Treaty of Rome, which created the European Economic Community, the creation of the European Parliament. For decades, Scotland had a number of MEPs standing up for Scotland in Europe. One of those MEPs sadly passed away last year, and I will conclude my remarks with the words by the lady affectionately known as Madame Escoisset on the continent. Our neighbours from the continent have always been welcome in Scotland. We had a French national, Christian Allard, from the northeast, representing us in the Scottish Parliament for a number of years. And it's important now more than ever at a time where the UK government's hostility towards those who hail from anywhere else to reiterate that welcome. Last month, along with my colleague Kevin Stewart, I welcomed the French Ambassador and Consul General to Aberdeen, and we discussed the rich past and vibrant present that the North East shares with France. Did you know that our national hero, Robert Bruce, himself of French origin, sent an embassy to the European continent in 1323 to renew the Old Alliance of 1295? This embassy included the Earl of Moray and the Bishop of Moray. The latter would even go on to establish the Scots College at the University of Paris way back in 1333. So our educational links with France and Europe go back at least seven centuries. William Elphinstone would go on to study at the University of Paris for a number of years before returning to Scotland to found the University of Aberdeen, modelling it on the French University, and now, many centuries later, the University of Aberdeen, alongside our other universities in Scotland, continue to welcome European students. And it bears repeating, our educational system and our country are richer for their presence. Brexit, however, has no doubt threatened that. European students are no longer eligible for tuition-free university education in Scotland. Sadly, the UK government's decision to ignore the will of the Scottish people and their pursuit of a hard Brexit, which tore us out of a number of EU programmes, including Erasmus+, continues to threaten our centuries-old educational, scientific and cultural exchanges with Europe. Last week, I was delighted to welcome to the Scottish Parliament the Consul General of France in Scotland, diplomats from the French Embassy in London, and a number of graduates who have benefited from the international mobility granted to them by schemes like Erasmus+. But each and every one of those I spoke to raised the urgency with which the loss of programmes like Erasmus+ needs to be reversed. Winnie Ewing was the architect of the Erasmus+ programme, which fuels fraternity between European nations. And so it is with the words of Madame Escoffier at the reconvening of our Scottish Parliament, Presiding Officer, that I will conclude. My last practical hope is that everyone born in Scotland or who has chosen Scotland as their country will live in harmony together with us all, enjoying the cultures, our cultures plural. Out there in Europe and in the world, the greater world, there is a bank of goodwill towards Scotland. Those words are as true today as they were then. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Adam. I now call Stephen Kerr, final speaker in the open debate, around 4 minutes. Mr Kerr.
Well, I congratulate Alistair Allen on this debate, but it's a great pity that the SNP didn't put as much energy into contesting the 2016 referendum campaign as they have since moaning about the result. They spent tuppence halfpenny on the campaign, and that was back when they had more than two farthings to rub together. No, it is in the best tradition of the SNP that they struggle to accept any referendum result. The people of the United Kingdom collectively decided that the United Kingdom's membership of the European Union had run its course, and I am no less a European today than I was on the day that Britain left the European Union. Of course, Scotland and the rest of the United Kingdom remains closely attached to Europe, both geographically and in every other respect. And there are lessons for the SNP that are on offer since we left the European Union. Let's take the economy. The UK economy is now the joint fastest growing economy in the G7, equal with Canada, outpacing France, Germany, Italy, Japan and the United States. Those are official figures. The UK is now the fourth largest exporter of goods and services globally, moving up from seventh place in the rankings in 2021. The United Kingdom has since overtaken France, the Netherlands and Spain. So what would be so bad about trying to keep up with the countries in the European Union and other areas too? For example, nuclear power. Here's John Swinney at FMQs on the 16th of May. The Scottish Government will not support new nuclear power stations in Scotland. And here's the contraposition from the European Union. The Council of the EU Member States and the European Parliament agreed on Tuesday, 6th of February, to label nuclear power as a strategic technology for the EU's decarbonisation. Will the SNP follow the EU's pragmatic lead and label nuclear power a strategic technology for Scotland's decarbonisation? Alistair Allen's about to tell me.
Alistair Allen.
Perhaps the member would acknowledge that the European Union leaves it up to member states as to which member state builds a nuclear power station, and we don't find EU member states attempting to tell each other to have nuclear power stations in their respective territories.
Stephen Kerr.
Well, Alistair Allen has his own excuses for the cover story that the SNP give for their denial of the science of nuclear energy. So let's try gene editing technology. The SNP remains opposed, but earlier this year the European Parliament voted to ease the regulation on gene-edited crops. Why not follow suit? And how about illegal immigration? Here's what the Austrian Chancellor said this week, and I know that the Cabinet Secretary has a great vested interest in Austria, so perhaps he's familiar with what the Chancellor said. The Rwanda model is a solution for us. to have asylum proceedings in safe third countries, and that is something we need to put on the EU's agenda as well. The UK is therefore a pioneer in this model, a model and a path that will be important for Europeans as well. We support the British path and the British model. And it's not just Austria, because week before last, 15 leaders of EU states, including Austria, called for new solutions to address illegal migration into Europe, which includes the idea of relocating asylum seekers to third countries. I'm reading this from the Times, by the way. I'm not making this up. The countries that signed the letter last week were Bulgaria, the Czech Republic, Denmark, Estonia, Greece, Italy, Cyprus, Latvia, Lithuania, Malta, the Netherlands, Austria, Poland, Romania, and Finland. And one last area where the SNP, I think, could stop bleating and do something positive, and it's already been mentioned. It's the moan about Erasmus Plus. Well, sitting alongside the Turing scheme for which Scottish students are eligible, the Welsh Government, Labour Government, and I'm a Tory, have set up Tithe. They will spend £65 million on Tithe up to 2026. I will give way to the Cabinet Secretary.
Grateful for Stephen Kerr giving way. The European Union has made it abundantly clear that the United Kingdom would be welcome back in the Erasmus Plus scheme and welcome back in Creative Europe. Does he agree that that would be the right thing to do?
Stephen Kerr, the Cabinet Secretary raises the current position of the European Union. The whole reason we got to this point was because they wouldn't allow the United Kingdom to remain part of Erasmus Plus, and hence Turing, and hence Tithe. And I speak in praise of Tithe, because students from Wales have both Turing and Tithe to allow them to continue to benefit from international exchanges, just like Erasmus. Except, I don't think I have the time, I do apologise. Except Erasmus, except with Turing, of course, and with Tithe, it goes beyond Europe. Now, look, now, the whole point of this is if the Welsh Government can do it, and by the way, the SNP promised to do it, why haven't the SNP delivered? Is it because the SNP prefer gum-bumping and grievance over delivering substance? Of course they do.
Thank you, Mr. Kerr. I now invite Angus Robertson to respond to the debate. Cabinet Secretary, around 7 minutes, please.
Thank you very much. Just at the outset, the preference of the Scottish Government is the United Kingdom joins Erasmus Plus and the United Kingdom Government rejoins Creative Europe. That's the answer to Stephen Kerr's question. May I begin my contribution by praising Dr. Alistair Allen for this motion, marking Europe Day, in which we mark the day in 1950 that Robert Schuman proposed bringing French and West German coal and steel production under a single authority. It happened the day after the anniversary of the surrender of Nazi Germany on the 8th of May 1945. And the connection between both of these things and the ultimate price paid by so many people, raised by Megan Gallagher, is absolutely right to acknowledge. In the shadow of the Second World War, the bold idea of working together across Europe was the seed of a peace project that grew into what has become the European Union. And recognition of that project could not be more important today. Russia's illegal war in Ukraine and the conflict in Gaza reminds us that peace and cooperation are precious, and indeed so precious that we must not take them for granted. On the 9th of May, on Europe Day, I had the pleasure of addressing Scotland's first International Festival of Europe, which took place in Edinburgh. I'm grateful to the European Movement in Scotland for inviting me. And I reflected then that from armed conflict to climate change and rapid technological change, the challenges facing our continent need a common response. And a united Europe is a universal idea, one rooted in common values of human dignity, of freedom and democracy. And indeed, one of the first to enunciate that vision was none other than Sir Winston Churchill in his famous speech in Zurich in 1946, where he called for the creation of a United States of Europe. In June this year, in a few weeks' time, over 400 million Europeans will go to the polls, and it will be the first time in 45 years in which Scottish voters have not taken part. And I remember with sadness the day that Scotland's members of the European Parliament were piped out of the European Parliament chamber. And our fellow Europeans were asked to leave a light on for Scotland, and I believe that the light is still burning bright for the day that we return. Brexit has been, and it is beyond any challenge, has been an unmitigated disaster for Scotland. The economic impact is well documented, but it's not just our economy that suffers. The ending of free movement of people has greatly impacted on people the length and breadth of Scotland, not least European Union citizens, to whom our message remains clear: you are welcome here, we want you to stay, and this is your home. And above all, we must not forget the impact on young people. It was an extraordinarily welcome move, only last month, by the European Commission, who proposed opening negotiations with the United Kingdom on a youth mobility treaty. Following the UK government's decision not to participate in Erasmus+, it was rejected out of hand, the offer of the European Commission, by the UK government. Is deeply disappointing. The only thing that is more disappointing is that the first to reject the proposal weren't even the UK government. It was the Labour Party. And I have to hope that common sense will prevail if there is to be a change in the UK government, that the offer by the Commission is taken seriously. Because if we are going to stand here as regularly as we do, and we are going to lament the impact that the ending of free movement of people has had, particularly on young people and on culture and the arts, that when we have an offer open to us, as we have on Erasmus+, as we have on Creative Europe, that we should take it seriously, of course, I'm pleased to give way.
Stephen Kerr.
I am grateful to the Cabinet Secretary for giving way. But would he please acknowledge to the Chamber that the SNP have a commitment to bring forward a programme equivalent to Tithe, the Welsh Government's version, which together with Turing creates an even more expansive opportunity for our young people and our students. Would he agree the SNP have got that commitment and have done nothing about it whatsoever? Where is the Scottish equivalent that the SNP promised to bring to this chamber and have still produced nothing?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, in point of fact, I mean, Stephen Kerr is wrong. The Scottish Government has been looking at all of the options, but what has become abundantly clear to us is the Turing scheme is not more expansive than Erasmus+ for students in Europe. It is not more expansive. It is a reduced offer. And I had the pleasure of sitting next to the UK ambassador when I was in discussions with the European Commission about the offer that they have to the UK in relation to Erasmus+. So I can confirm to Stephen Kerr, the offer is there. The offer is there. They are happy for the UK to join. We are happy for the UK to join. And I care not whether it is an outgoing Tory government in London that wakes up and sees the common sense of doing so, or the potential Labour government. What really matters is that we embrace the opportunity of being back in Erasmus+. It is a very important part of the idea of European citizenship. And for the record, it has been quite right, and we've heard already this afternoon, to recognise the role that Winnie Ewing played in the creation of the Erasmus scheme. I'm overrunning time, so I'm going to proceed and I'm going to wind up shortly. We urge the UK government to think again, to respond positively to the Commission's initiative, to negotiate a deep and generous agreement with the EU. And more than that, we urge whoever is in number 10 in months ahead to include the UK's relationship with the EU and an openness to once again embrace Erasmus, Creative Europe and all that this offers. But freedom of movement is only one reason why I want Scotland to return to the European Union as a member state in our own right, and our detailed policy paper, An Independent Scotland in the EU, was published last year, and it set out our vision of shared values, of what we can contribute to the European Union, and the benefits that Scotland will gain from being a member state in our own right for the very first time. Our ambition is to be an open nation that seeks to be a global citizen, that is a force for good, which leaves a positive mark in the world. These are all aspirations that we share with our European neighbours. So in closing, Presiding Officer, the founding principles of a united Europe ring true today more than ever, and the message to our European friends from this Parliament's debate on Europe Day is that Scotland is by your side, and we will continue to work with you to address the many challenges that we share.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. That concludes the debate, and I suspend this meeting of Parliament until 2:30.